reassurance as far as you're concerned. So there you are. It's been great meeting you. And before you go, would you do me a favour?
Sure.
Would you help me open those doors?
No worries.
Terribly heavy. Okay, come on.
It's good news for Paul.
Cheers. All the
best.
Thank
you very much.
Well done.
Cheers. Thanks.
And as Dr. George gets back to work, the Beach Doctor's medical mission continues. They won't rest until they've made Britain a healthier place.
Our GPs have now packed up their beach towels and are heading for Britain's streets for a new series of Street Doctors starting on BBC One on September the 3rd. Join them there.
Yes, so let's go back to our Roman dig near Peterborough.
Hello, Neil.
Hello. Hello there. We've been having a lovely day in the country. It's been very exciting and also very busy. And the man coordinating all of that and having all of the headaches is lead archaeologist David Connolly. Now, David, how has it been for you so far?
This has been one of the most exciting days of my life, I've got to tell you.
It's so big. There's so many people. The area that we're trying to cover and investigate is so big. How do you cope with it?
Well, it's a complicated problem, a simple solution. Basically, all we did was we gave the detectorists bags, tags and pens, and my archaeologists followed them in the field with GPS to locate the finds. The artifacts come back here, and our find specialists then record them and identify them. Simple as that.
So it's a good opportunity to make the best of what you do as archaeologists and what the detectorists do.
Absolutely, yeah.
Now let's have a look at some of the artifacts that are coming out.
Oh,
now,
yes.
Even with my relatively untrained eye, I can spot that right away as well, maybe a gent's ring. But what more can you tell us about it?
Well, it's a Roman ring. It's a Roman signet ring. And you'll probably not be able to see this, but right in the middle, there's some marks. Now, you'll have to take my word for it, but that's a rabbit.
Apart from being a piece of personal jewellery, would it have had a function because it's engraved in that way?
It does have a function. It's a sort of a personal stamp.
The fascination for me is that it speaks of a person, doesn't it? We suddenly get a real Romano-British person.
Yep, there it is.
Now, I was teasing Adrian with this lovely item earlier. Alan, join us.
Hello.
Now, you're the man who actually found this.
I am indeed.
We think of detectorists being attracted to gold and silver, but does this work for you as well? This is iron.
It does indeed. All the guys that you see here today, they're not actually out searching for pots of gold or riches or anything like that. It's just everybody here today has a keen interest in history, and that as a piece is fantastic.
David, what is it and how rare is it?
Well, it's actually a finger key, believe it or not. And if I just slip it on my finger like that, there we go, I can then open up a chest.
And what would have opened or closed?
Well, I was saying it's a strong box, perhaps? Small door?
Fantastic, wonderful. Thanks, Alan.
Thank you very much.
Best of luck for the rest of the weekend. Now, this one here, I had this one pointed out to me. I knew it was a coin, but beyond that, I was at a loss. I can see maybe a hint of gold. How significant a find is this?
This is a cracking find here. It's a coral talvate stator, a gold stator.
Well said.
It actually is a lot more interesting than it sounds. This coin is normally found north of the Humber, and so we have it here, but it belongs to a tribe whose capital was actually Leicester. Having it here is incredibly important for us.
And how fascinating to imagine that, you know, in the century before the Romans even came here, things were being bought and sold, currency was changing hands, people were living those normal lives.
It's that personal thing again, where, you know, you're holding something which actually was in somebody's hand, you know, nearly 2,000 years ago.
We're going to get the proof of the pudding out of this weekend, whether we can all work together. And clearly, if it's going to work or fail, we're going to find out over the next couple of days. Come back on Monday.
We'll join you on Monday, certainly, and do let us know if you've found anything with your metal detector, anything unusual, incredible, or just depressingly mundane would be quite interesting.
Maybe
as well.
Maybe they could tease you as well.
yes, tease me with your finds. Send us your pictures and we'll do them next week. Hope you've enjoyed your one show week as much as we have.
It was a bad one if you liked your macaroni cheese to obey the laws of gravity.
Delicious. Rather better hospital food for this flooded out hedgehog though. Look at him go, fantastic.
We love this shot from 1967 of a British moon rocket making stately progress through Stevenage in Hertfordshire.
Beware on Mutton Lane, there's roadworks there. Rather less joy in our report, I'm afraid, on the advent of knife-proof kids' clothing, if you don't mind. Incredible.
And we apologise for lingering so long on footage of this infected toe.
As for our team,
Mylene went into labour on the one show sofa. And Dom got nicked.
Wasn't all bad then. And I went to the trouble of dressing up as Elvis Presley and ended up looking even more like Benny Hill than usual. Humiliating it was. That's it from us. On Monday's show, we'll be finding out if our metal detectors have struck Roman gold, or pottery at least.
Plus, Carol Thatcher tries to flog pasties to the French, and super chef Raymond Blanc will be here too. See you on Monday at 7.
Have a good weekend.
Bye. Bye.
The one to watch tonight.
She's got cyst pressing against her stomach. She's starving to death.
Fabra, who wants to just do things by the book?
We're saving her life. Can't go back now.
Holby City at 9 on BBC One Scotland.
On TV, radio and online. Scotland's Musical 7.
The battle begins again. Glasgow streets resound to the skirl of mass pipes as over 8,000 musicians from around the world compete in the Premier Piping Festival. Jackie Bird presents highlights of the World Pipe Band Championships Sunday at 5:45 on BBC One Scotland.
Bruce Parry becomes one of the tribe, Tuesday at 9 on BBC Two.
Dino's getting cold feet, but will he change his story? EastEnders in half an hour. Now on BBC One Scotland in a Change to the Build episode, we're in the ultimate outdoors on the 4th Rail Bridge.
The 4th Bridge in Scotland is an icon from the Victorian industrial age. Once it was the largest bridge in the world, over a mile and a half long and soaring to a height of 370 feet. Keeping it smart has always been an endless task. Everybody's heard the line about painting the 4th Bridge.
I heard it was never ending.
It is a well-known thing.
Very well-known thing.
It's always been painted.
I mean, you obviously see it, but then, you know, they paint one end and then they start again and then they paint the other end and then they start again and then they paint the other end.
But now the bridge is getting a makeover with a difference. Once these guys are finished, they won't ever be back again.
Good morning, William.
Good morning, Robertson.
It's Friday.
It's 7 a.m. Rab Harrow is starting his day.
Just doing the usual tagging. All right.
Each morning, every man has to sign a register.
Friday again, Paul. Can I sign on your sheet, please? Yeah.
So if there's an emergency, it's known exactly who is out on the bridge.
I'll do the same again once I get to the other side, Willie. I'll give you a shout, let me know. Okay, thanks, Willie.
Thanks, Robert. Thank you,
see you later.
Cheers, Willie.
Have a nice day.
Thank you.
And then the long, hair-raising walk begins. Working on the bridge is like no other place on Earth. This is a hazardous job. You have to contend with extreme conditions, extreme weather, and high-speed trains. But even getting out here is no mean feat. You've got to have a head for height.
You know you're high when the birds are flying below you.
There's currently a staggering 4,000 tonnes of scaffolding on the bridge. That's equal to 11 fully laden jumbo jets. Rab's job is to check the scaffold is secure.
Well, this is a scaff tag system. As long as that tag is removed, The stag states, do not use or do not use a scaffold. That means that the scaffold's condemned or they're working on it. And every 7 days, it gets inspected, registered and signed. But as long as it's got that registered on there, it's safe to use. It's just like an MOT. If you MOT a car, it's safe to use for that one day.
Everybody's safety depends on these checks.
From here, well, if you had to fall through a scaffold, you'd probably fall in about 150 feet.
In fact, men have fallen to their death from this bridge. Painters used to climb up with no protection whatsoever. No scaffold, no harness, no safety line.
No, that's it, done there. Well, you need to push it for there, a bridge got up there.
Ricky Lynch is one of the scaffolders. His family has a long history with the bridge.
Well, my dad worked here when he was in his teens. He was a painter in Monkhouse. I'm going back, well, many years ago now. I've all worked in here. It was all done different then. There wasn't much scaffolding going up. It was all done to cradles and that. Scary.
I hope I don't slip. I hope I don't slip.
Hold that. Fall too hard.
Ricky's been working on the bridge for so long that he's affectionately known as Grandad.
Great Grandad. Still got the bingo rack here.
Peter, you still got the bingo! Aye!
Most scaffolders couldn't do this job.
The bridge itself isn't a square bridge. Everything is at an angle. So you've actually got to build the scaffold to the angles. So it's a unique bit of scaffolding.
Rather than being built upwards, this scaffolding is suspended downwards.
Ricky, but look! Ricky!
Oh,
Kerry, you've got some strength on your arms.
Oh, yeah, f***ing you.
What? Oh, you're off your muscle.
Bingo! Aye! Smoke break! Smoke break! Get him gasping!
But they actually use a special tool, a spirit level. It's actually got an angle device on it, so that when they put it onto their levels, on their uprights, they actually know that they're following the same angle as the bridge.
That's perfect.
There are 170 men permanently working on the bridge.
People still have that myth that every man comes on site with a paintbrush and goes up on the bridge and starts painting. I don't think they have the thought of actually everything that's involved and actually getting a coat of paint on it.
Incredibly, over 30 different jobs are involved before even a drop of paint touches steel. There are scaffolders, end cappers, blasters, welders, electricians, planners, engineers, safety crew, boat crew, labourers, and bridge control. Spender Kirkland is one of the paint supervisors. He's checking to see if the undercoat is okay.
It's double thickness of where you would get it elsewhere on the bridge. Purely and simply because this is the area that's going to be battered and bruised more by the weather conditions.
All these tough jobs are done by men. In fact, they've never had any women even apply to work here.
The fact that, no disrespect to the females, but it is very, very physical. There is a lot of physical women in Scotland, but it's a very physical job, and it's just not for them, I suppose.
Is it a job you'd want to do?
No, definitely not. My heart goes out to them, but it wouldn't be a job I would do.
The fact that a lot of people can work at height, but you've got a big combination of working at height, working over water, you have the elements, the high winds, everything rolled into one. Whether it's bravery or stupidity is kind of the influence whether or not you're going to be capable of working on a structure like this. It's very, very much a man's world. It's a man's world.
Well, I've been in the scaffolding game for about 35 years. But I've been on here coming up 10 and a half years on the actual bridge.
Did you like working the bridge?
Yes, it's brilliant. Because it's unique, a bit of history, and it's close to my house. I can actually open my bedroom window in the morning and look straight at the bridge.
Well, when you're flying home for anywhere in the world, you usually come in that way, so you know you're home.
In terms of its engineering marvel, it's just a fantastic structure.
I used to cross the bridge when I was a youngster on steam trains, and we used to throw a halfpenny or a farthing, try and get over the side for good luck. So there's a fortune line at the bottom of there somewhere.
Yeah, to have that sort of a piece of history in the background will always mean a lot to us, yeah.
They began building the fourth bridge in 1883. It took more than 50,000 tons of steel to construct the bridge. 5,000 men worked for 7 years to build it. But there was a cost in human lives. During the construction, a tenth of the workforce suffered injuries, and records list 65 men that died, although the actual death toll was likely to have been a lot higher. They only recorded a death when it took place on the bridge itself. One logbook of accidents and sickness had 26,000 entries. Nowadays, everything possible is put in place to stop any fatalities or injuries. And that's why Spender has to regularly monitor the wind speeds and check if it's safe for the men to be working.
The weather's one of the biggest factors on here for starting and stopping work. We need to keep an eye on the weather because of where we are. It can get to the point where it can turn around and bite you straight away. We're okay. Get 20 mile an hour, 5 minutes time it could be 40, 50 mile an hour, and say, right, is it safe, is it unsafe, and stop any works as according.
For years, the bridge has been battered by the elements. The wind is a particular hazard. Nobody steps foot on the bridge until it's been checked.
So I'm just gonna take out my anemometer, and we'll go across and take a wind speed on the bottom platform here and we'll see what we can get. Actually sitting around about a constant 19. So even that, if the lads are out, especially the scaffolders, if they're on an open edge, they might have to come off and stop the work and go elsewhere. But at the moment, we're fine.
This is good news for Andy Miller, who's in charge of the end capping team.
When the weather's good, we hang all the sheeting.
What they do is always noticed by the public.
The derail bridge is just looking a mess at the moment.
What in particular looks a mess?
All that white stuff in the wrapping. It looks like wrapping paper around it and it just looks horrible.
Unbeknown to most, All that white stuff has a very specific purpose.
It's encapsulation. It's to keep the environment clean. Stop the dust from going out for when the blast of steel work with the grit. If the rain comes in and runs down the steel, they can't blast it, can't paint it.
The encapsulation serves two purposes. It keeps the elements out and keeps the dust in, as any leakage could contaminate the water below with old paint and rust.
You try and seal every single bit, every single place.
The sheets of plastic are rolled out around the scaffolding. Any tiny holes or gaps are taped over to create a sealed environment where the boys play it. Well, being boys, really.
That's Spider-Man. Because he's got a Spider-Man duvet still in his bed and a Spider-Man poster up above his bed. Another one up there, he'll be hiding, he's called a rat. It suits him too. He even answers to it. And there's the wee munchkin. The penguin, that's my brother. He thinks he gets away with things, but doesn't he? The residents asked why it was white and not red. But if it was red, you wouldn't be able to see in here. You'd have to rig up lights everywhere. Try and get this done as quick as we can. It's the weather what beats us.
For Rab and the scaffolders, there aren't just tricky angles to deal with. There's also the fact that the whole bridge moves.
It's what they call a perfect canal. It moves all the time with the flow of the traffic and everything else. I didn't realise what it was like until I started working here. The movements in it. When you go along with the centre span and it's no linked together, and it all moves when the coal trains come over.
This was not the original idea for the bridge. Initially, a man named Thomas Bouch, otherwise known as Botch, first designed it. But just when they'd started construction, his previous bridge over the River Tay collapsed. 75 people died. He became synonymous with shoddy workmanship, and that's where the term botched job came from. New engineers were brought in, and they came up with the moving cantilever design. Nowadays, the bridge remains a vital transport link between Edinburgh and the north of Scotland, with over 200 trains crossing every day. There are men whose sole job is to warn of approaching trains. There are very good reasons why safety is taken so seriously. Fraser Marshall's family know all about the Forth Bridge.
I was still at school, secondary school, when I lost my eldest brother.
Fraser's brother was a painter who fell from the bridge. But that was not their only tragedy.
And I lost my father in 1972, off the bridge.
Fraser's dad was a rigger killed on Christmas Eve when the platform he was working on collapsed into the Forth. His body was never recovered. Despite the double tragedy, when Fraser finished school, he too wanted to work at the bridge.
My mother was a wee bit apprehensive, I would think. But she seemed to be okay that I was working on the permanent way rather than climbing about the bridge. And when there's accidents, fatalities, it sort of brings it home to everyone that it can be a dangerous job.
Since the grand opening in 1890, he knows how many people have died on the bridge. But a memorial is being built in honour of the countless people who've lost their lives.
I am now, and probably I've seen the bridge almost every day. Anyone that comes to work here on the bridge, I think they get an affinity to the bridge. They sort of claim it as their own because they have helped to do something to the bridge. It's an icon.
You might think exposure to the elements is the worst part of working on the bridge, but the most extreme job is hidden from view. Before the men can even think about doing this job, they must wear protective gear, and they have to breathe and communicate through an umbilical cord.
One's an airline, which is obviously to feed your helmet. Then you've also got your power for your lights. And then you've got your communication cord. And that goes right down to the person what's at the bottom. And that's how you keep in contact with your headset and his headset.
Right, Alan. Just a second, Alan.
The guys make their way to the encapsulation rooms.
You've got to climb up 360 odd feet with all your gear in. No magic formula, eh?
Hundreds of feet below, grit and air are mixed at high pressure. When the men are at the work site, the valves are released.
Hello, Alan. Ready? Here goes.
This is grit blasting. The old lead paint is stripped away with a high pressure hose. It's such a powerful tool that within seconds, the steel is stripped bare of layers of rust and old paint.
I would believe it would cut through flesh quite easy.
And bone.
Sometimes the blasters can twist in your hand, and it's really, it's like arm wrestling all day, if you know what I mean.
Conditions are grim. With dust, lead, and grit filling the atmosphere, visibility quickly goes.
Yeah, I don't think you're actually aware of what's behind you. Well, obviously, when you're blasting, we keep away from each other, eh? And we are aware that there's no danger behind you, but all you're doing is concentrating on that surface in front of you.
We were lucky to get these images before our camera was destroyed by flying debris. After blasting, the guys need to have a thorough wash. There's a risk of blood poisoning from the old leaded paint.
So every 3 months we get taken in for a blood test. We get our blood tested to see the lead level is up. Well, if our lead level was up that high anyway, we would probably get taken off the job, eh?
Once a week, on Saturday nights, the trains stop, and the men get the tracks to themselves. It's a critical time for bringing vital supplies onto the bridge and taking rubbish away. And everyone's hard at it. Drinking cups of tea, that is. The guys are waiting for the last train to pass through.
Okay, Ronnie, thanks very much. Okay, mate, thank you. Bye. That was our yard manager. Unfortunately, we don't have the possession yet, so we'll be sitting about drinking tea a little while longer. But if there's a late train coming, we can't do anything till it's passed.
2 hours and many tea bags later, the call they've been waiting for finally comes through.
Right. Right, cheers, Joe.
It's 1:30 a.m. and the guys can now make their way through the hatch and up onto the track.
Shut the hatch, Lonnie, eh?
At high speed in the darkness, the guys work hard and fast along the length of the bridge.
And this is just the general debris, you know, bits of end cap, bits of timber, just light material so it can go into this skip. We might get 3 runs tonight. Earlier on I thought we'd be struggling to get 2, but now that we're out here and things is going well, I think we'll maybe get the 3. So just got to keep on going. With.
By dawn, the rubbish is gone and the stores are resupplied with paint.
We're expecting the weather to feel like spring for the first time today. Light breeze and plenty of sunshine are in store. The perfect day for doing that DIY.
Once again, Rab's checking that his scaffold hasn't been overloaded.
Well, this is one of the many loading bays right throughout the bridge. This is one of the areas that they would store the materials. It's capable of taking about 16 tonne, this job. Yeah, anybody that's on the job, they'll actually see it. It's a special purpose, 16 ton. So they would know then that's the capacity of 16 ton. So that's what they would work to. That's it. Pop it back in again.
Once again, Spender is watching yet more paint dry. There are 45 acres to cover, and everywhere we'll get 4 coats.
Right.
Normally full cure within about 48 hours, but if it's during the winter and it's cold outside, it can take 3 days, 4 days. It's really weather dependent again, so that has a big factor on the curing time of the paint.
So the bridge has got a good character?
Definitely. It's like a woman. Full of moods. Very big mood swings. It can be very friendly and very, very hostile at times. But if you treat her with respect, she'll respect you back.
But at long last, it's time for the final coat in classic Forth Bridge red. And if you ever wondered why the bridge has always been this particular shade, well, the designers were thinking ahead. It doesn't show the rust. In this section, all the planning, scaffolding, end capping and blasting is nearing completion.
I've had my good times here.
Ricky, you want to get engaged to Tina on national TV?
It'll be nice when it's all painted. It'll look nice.
Soon, the whole bridge will be done. The world's most famous painters and decorators will finally hang up their brushes and the scaffolding will come down.
I was here when it started. I've been right through all the phases and I'd like to see it finished.
And when it's all finished, the old lady won't need another makeover for 30 years.
What's the best bit about the job?
Seeing the scaffold coming.